Hello, welcome again to the Daily Sporran, and today I'm going to do a song called Locomotive Breath, perhaps the most iconic Jethro Tull song of all from the 1971 Aqualung album. A song that's many songs really rolled into one. It's a rock anthem in its own right. It's Jethro Tull's probably most heard song. It's a staple of classic rock radio. It's a song you will have heard if you've seen Jethro Tull since 1972, because it's been in every show since for the last 51 years or so. And it comes in the show at the end of the show or in the encore. And Ian Anderson, after the piano introduction, comes on twirling his flute, and everyone stands up for the first time and fist pumps the air, and it provides a kind of rock anthem conclusion to the show. And for that reason, a lot of fans think it's overplayed and overheard, but actually underneath this song is a song with a huge amount of craft in it, so much so that it was a really difficult song to record. Had a very troubled birth, this song. The band and Ian Anderson couldn't quite connect on how to translate his vision of the music, lyrics and rhythm into a recorded version. And I'll say a bit more about that at the end. Anyway, hope you enjoy my version. Wish me luck. Shuffling madness of the locomotive breath runs the all-time loser headlong to his death. Well, he feels the piston scraping, steam breaking on his brow. Old Charlie stole the handle, and the train, it won't stop going, no way to slow. Children jumping off at stations one by one. His woman and his best friend in bed and having fun. Well, he's crawling down the corridor on his hands and knees. Old Charlie stole the handle, and the train won't stop going, no way to slow. Silence howling and catches angels as they fall, and the all-time winner has got him by the balls. Well, he Bible. It's open at page one. I think that God, he stole the handle, and the train won't stop going. No way to slow down. 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 Well, where to begin with this song? Most people, when they hear this song, just hear. But that's really, I mean, that's a really important part of this song. But let me give you some more things about this song that I think make it quite magical. The original idea for this song is that it's a song about, well, it's about two things, really. If you read the lyrics and hear the song, you think it's about the trials and tribulations of a man struggling to combine work with a kids and a family and a wife that maybe having an affair with his best friend, and he just can't keep everything, and he has to keep the show on the road. And the locomotive is the metaphor for having to keep the show on the road, and the way that life just keeps going, no matter what the stresses and strains are, and provides itself more stresses and strains because of the fact that it keeps chugging along. It just won't slow down. So the sound of this had to represent the locomotive, and that was really the struggle that Ian Anderson had with the band members and communicating it properly. And the two elements of the main riff that have that feel are the musical riff itself and the rhythm, because you have to keep that chugging going throughout. Chugging locomotive or the tick-tock of the clock, either way, or both perhaps, it's a wonderful metaphor. It's a very rare Jethro Tull song that gives you such a firm chord and rhythmic constraint within which everything has to happen, but this is one of those examples. And the way that Ian Anderson does it in the main part of the song is he turns it into a blues song. It's a classic call and response kind of song. Think of a song like Trouble. If you're looking for trouble, you came to the right place. So this has the same feeling, right? In the shuffling madness of the locomotive breath runs the all-time loser. So it has that blues feel to it, riff, spoken or sung verse, riff, spoken or sung riff, spoken or sung melody. But melodically, it's so much more interesting than a lot of more straightforward songs in this genre. I mean, I'll give you a couple of examples. Think of the second verse. He sees his children jumping off at the stations one by one. Now that's very Chicago blues, right? His woman and his best friend. Now listen to this bit. In bed and having fun. What he does there is he goes up to the B, which is the dominant of the E minor. And his melody goes. And for those of you who know about major and minor chords, he's playing both the major third and the minor third there. Or he's singing the major third and the minor third in the same breath. In bed and having fun. Well, he's crawling down the corridor. It's just this beautiful range of bluesy stylistic vocals and lovely playing with major and minor thirds. I love it so much. Beautifully done. Before this riff, of course, however, you get 2 minutes, fantastic early 2 minutes of this song, which is really metaphorically the giving birth to the locomotive. That's the way I like to think of it. It starts with John Evan, who was asked to play a classical or a piece of music to introduce this on the piano. And of course, John Evan had been with the band for about a year at this point when this song was recorded. He'd been playing a lot of classical music live. If you listen to Living in the Past, you'll hear him play By Kind Permission Of, which is Beethoven and other things mashed together in a classical music interlude. He learned to play classical music with his mum growing up on the piano. He played classical music in the sound checks all the way through until the very end of Jethro Tull, his time with Jethro Tull in 1980. So classical music is in the ether for John Evan, and he starts with a very classically sounding riff. and that keeps going into in E minor. But after a while, it starts to modulate into a more bluesy rather than classical piece of music. So from classical to blues, and then it just gives birth to the beginning of the locomotive sound, almost like the engine is just being started up. It's warming up now. And then after a while you get the first burst of the main riff. Till it finally delivers the main riff and stops, and then we're off. So the locomotive has kind of come into being. It's like a sort of emergence of the premise of the song over 2 minutes, beautifully unfolding from classical to blues, from piano to guitar. It's beautifully done, really wonderful. Anyway, I hope you enjoy. And next time you hear this song live, perhaps, or just on the radio, go back to the original and think of it as a piece of the craft of the song, the way that Ian Anderson tried to and failed to convey this idea of a locomotive chugging along. He says, by the way, that this song is really about population growth. I've never quite believed that, or I've never really seen the evidence for it in the song. I'm sure it's what he intended, but when you hear this song, it really feels like the pressures that surround the normal life, and it's a wonderful representation of that. So that's what we should remember the next time we hear this song, the craft that went into trying to depict that sense of the daily pressures of life. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed it. See you soon.